Okay, hello to everybody. Okay, today is the first day that Pedro Master was, I see him in charge of the seminar program here in Bay City. Then let's thank her for taking again this effort. That takes a while to be sure about it. The second thing I want to say also, she's not here today, that's the reason I am introducing this seminar. And the second thing I want to tell also is, yes, I want to thank Bernd for the work he has done during the last years. Okay, another new thing is that from today on, all the seminars are going to be emitted via streaming, by internet, and they will be also recorded. But today, okay, the stream connection is saved already, then it's local, but we are recording the seminar and will be available on the webpage from the next few days. But we hope that next week the seminar will be already emitted via stream. Okay. Then let's introduce our speaker today. She is Belén Torres. She is here. She's visiting the Institute for half a year. She will be still for a while. Okay, Belén studied physics in the first 3 years in the Universidad Complutense de Madrid, and then she moved to Universidad de La Laguna in the Canary Islands, where she did the last 2 years of the specialization in astrophysics and also the master program. In fact, many of you were colleagues of her at the epoch of the university, a number of you, in fact. Okay, then you know her before than me. Okay, then after finishing the master in astrophysics, she moved to the University of Valencia, where she has done the PhD. She had an FBI grant, and she did her PhD making about the subject she's going to talk today about. It's about the spectral interferometric studies of red supergiants. She has been, her supervisors were John Markaite from the University of Valencia and Marcos Witowski from the ESO. In fact, she spent quite a lot of time in ESO during her PhD period. And what she has done is she has studied the atmospheres of these red supergiants, taking as control sample the normal supergiant stars, and she has tried to characterize the atmospheres of these stars, making full use of the spectral capabilities of Amber VLTI, the instrument that permits to do long baseline interferometry studies in the near infrared. Okay. She's during the time she's working here, she's trying to increase her studies. Studying first the envelopes of these stars, making use of weather masers, and making use of very long distance interferometry radio. And also she is trying to obtain images of these stars with Pioneer, that's another instrument that is available on the VLTI. And finally, also through observations with Vizier. In fact, this is the first project she's developing with us, studying the atmospheres with Vizier, making use of the new observed modes that have been making available in the last months. Okay, then I'm sure she's going to give us a very nice talk, and whenever you want. Okay.
Thank you very much, Anton. Okay, as Anton said, I am going to speak about my work in the study of red supergiants and red giants with the technique of spectral interferometry with AMBER. Okay, first I am going to speak a little about the technique that we use, the optical infrared interferometry. Later I speak a little about the star that we observed, the red giants and the red supergiants. After that, I speak very quickly about the three theoretical model that we use, and after that, I show some of the results that we obtained. Okay, why we do study this? Okay, our motivation for this study is try to understand better the structure of the atmosphere of this star, and increase the sample that has observed with the increase the sample that is observed of red supergiants with interferometry. So our aims are estimated the fundamental parameters of this star and located them in the ATR diagram, and try to study their atmosphere. Okay, what is the interferometry? Okay, the interferometry is a technique which combines the beams of two or more telescopes to hybridize an interferometric panel. With this, we obtained a high angular resolution. For example, if we observe it in near infrared, as we did, for example, around 2.3 micrometers, and we observe it with a large telescope, a simple telescope, with a mirror of 10 meters, we can see a coin at a distance of 2,220 kilometers. But if we use the interferometry, we can use a small telescope, but separately between them, and we can see the same coin more far. For example, if the distance between the both telescopes are 120 meters, we can see the same coin at a distance of 3,440 kilometers. So we obtained high resolutions with this technique. Or the source that we observed start very big, but they are very far. So the angular diameter of them are around 3 milliseconds and 15 milliseconds, more or less. So for study in detail their atmosphere, we need a high resolution. For this, this technique is very good for our study. Okay, there are a lot of interferometry, but here I speak very quickly about the more important, the current more important interferometry. The first one is CHARA. It's an interferometry that is in the Monte Wilson in California. We have six telescopes of 1 meter each one. We have this one. It works with optical and infrared wavelength, and it can work with baseline between 30 and 3,000 meters. On the other hand, there are another interferometry that is Navy prototype optical interferometry. It is for Lowell Observatory in Arizona. It has four fixed astrometric stations and six stations for imaging. This station can be stay in different positions for change the baseline. The baseline is the distance between the both telescopes. It works also in optical and in infrared near infrared interferometry, and this one is the baseline that can be used. This one is the VLTI, is the interferometry that we use. It's in Cerro Paranal in Chile. It can work with four telescopes of 8.2 meters and with telescope of 1.8 meters. It works with optical and infrared wavelength, and their baseline can be between 1,030 meters. Later I speak a little more about this interferometry. And finally, SUSY is a Powell observatory in Australia. In this case, there are only one baseline that is in the direction of north south. It works only in optical, and the baseline can be between this one. Okay, the VLTI. The VLTI is the interferometry that we use. Here is a diagram about it works. First, the light arrives to the telescope, and after that, the light beams go through to a complex system of mirror and go to read the delay line. The delay line is some part that compensate the optical path difference between the two arms, because we have the line that go to the one telescope and for the second telescope. Maybe you can use more, but the delay line compensate the optical path for the different telescope, And now all the line binds have the same optical path. So now you can combine it for obtain the interferometry, the interferometry trans. So after the D-line line, the line goes through to the laboratory where the different instruments are. Okay, the VLTI can work with two types of telescopes. The unit telescope, that are the bigger. There are four fixed telescopes of 8.2 meters with altazimuth mount, and it can work with adaptive optics. And on the other hand, are the auxiliary telescope, that is the telescope that we use. This one is a four telescope of 1.8 meters, and they are mounted on track, so he can relocate in different positions to change the baseline that he used. Here it also have altazimuth mount. Okay, the VLTI have three telescopes, three instruments, MIDI, AMBER, and Pioneer, and two more instruments for second generations. MIDI, AMBER, and Pioneer is work now. MIDI combine the lines for two telescopes. AMBER combine the lines for three telescopes, is the instrument that we use. Pioneer combine the lines for four telescopes, and it's synced for imaging. And Gravity Images is, as I said, is a second generation instrument. Gravity has been his first line some days ago, and Matisse will be installed maybe this year or the next year. The both instruments combine the line for the four telescopes. Gravity is synced for astrometry and image, and Matisse is for image. Okay, AMBER. AMBER is the instrument that we use it for obtaining the results that I saw here. It's an instrument that works in near infrared. You can obtain data with band GH or CAT. Okay, sorry. Combine the line for three telescopes. So you can obtain it visibility for three special frequencies, closer phase, and a spectrum of each telescope. The line for the three telescopes, for the three telescopes, arrive to the instrument, and at the beginning, a part of the line is separated for obtaining the spectral pattern. And the rest of the line is combined for the instrument for obtaining the interferometry channel. So in the data that you obtain, you have three channels for spectrum, and one channel for interferometry. It can work with spectral resolutions, with low resolutions, medium resolutions, and high resolutions. The data that I saw here is with medium resolutions. It can resolve features between 2 milliseconds and 50 milliseconds. And it also works with finito, that is an external frame tracker, for establishing their frames. Okay, now. I speak a little about the star that we observed. As I said, we observed our studies. The objective is the red supergiants, but we also observed red giants as a test of our theoretical models. Okay, both stars are of spectral type K or M. They have a low effective temperature, and the difference between the both stars are their masses. The red giants have a star with intermediate mass between 3 and 8 solar mass, more or less. It's not very clear the limits of this. And the red supergiants is a massive star Where their masses are between 10 and 40 solar mass. Maybe it's better to see the different characterizations of this star in the HR diagram and their positions. Well, this one is the HR diagram. Here we have the red supergiant, and there are the red supergiants. As we can see, both stars have the same spectral type and same effective temperature, but the red giants have a lower luminosity than the red supergiants. The red giants have three phases. First, this one is the one evolutionary path for one red giant with a mass similar to the Sun, and this one also is the, but in this case the star have a solar mass, sorry, a mass with five solar mass. Okay, the red giants begin the first phase are red giant bands. After that, the red giants pass to the horizontal branch and finally go to the asymptotic giant branch. The internal structure of the red giants are different between the different phases. Where are they? During the red giant branch, the star don't burn in their the helium in their core, so this star has an inert core of helium and a shell where the hydrogen is burning. This phase finished when happened the flash helium. That is the moment where the helium begin to burn in the core. After that, the star go to the horizontal branch where the helium is burning in the core, and finally in the asymptotic giant branch, the star have an inert core of carbon and two different cells where the helium and the hydrogen is burning. In contrary, the red supergiant are more massive star, so it can burn in different elements in the core. At the beginning of this phase, the star have a core with he have a core where when the carbon is burning in the core. And during the phase, the different elements as carbon, oxygen, neon, magnesium, and silicon is burning in the core. Finally, at the end of this phase, the star have an inner core of iron and different cells where the different elements are burning. The atmosphere of red supergiants have extended atmospheric layers, molecular layers. So it means that this star have the photosphere, and later they have molecular layers but very far to the photosphere. This one is a schematic that we think that the atmosphere of this star are. Okay, we want to study the atmospheric and why. Our study is focused in why these molecular layers are extended. So for that, we use three theoretical models. The first one that we use is Phoenix. It's a hydrostatic model of one dimension from Housiel and Barrow. After that, we use a convection model of three dimensional. It has two parts. First one, a radiative hydrodynamical simulations from Freytag, and after that, a local thermodynamic equilibrium radiative transfer code, estimate, take these simulations and estimate the intensity map that we use. This part is from Shiabasa et al. And finally, we use a pulsation model of one dimension. We use a new self-excited pulsation model with parameters of red supergiants, and as a text, we use the codex model. The codex model is a self-excited pulsation model with parameters of Mira stars. Okay, now I am show the results that we obtained. This one is very schematic, the stars that we observed. We observed 10 red supergiants and 5 red giants, 4 different spectral types. I don't show all the results because there are a lot of, so and I only select the more representative. I am going to show the results of this 6002 Carina, HD183589, and B616 and for the red giants, I am going to show the result of Epsilon Octave and Beta Pegasus. Okay. This one is the first result for B602 Carina. In this graphic, I saw the spectrum, the normalized plots versus the wave line. In black are our observations, and in red are the best fit Phoenix model that we use for this star. We see that the spectrum decreasing below the 2.3, and we also observed a strong absorption CO lines. We also see that the Phoenix model fits very well to our observation in the spectrum. It means that the opacity are well implemented in this model. But when we observed the visibility, we observed a problem. Here we have the square visibility amplitude versus the waveline. In black is again our observations. In red are the best fit Phoenix model that we use for this star, is the same star. And in blue is the best fit unit for this model that we use. We observe in our observation, we observe that the visibility are constant in the continuum, that is this part. But when we go to the CO bands, we observe that the visibility decreasing in this one, and we observe large drops of CO. It means that this star have a very extended CO layers, and we think that this slope that we observe, this one, is due to maybe a water vapor. We see that the synthetic visibility for the Phoenix model in the continuum fit well with the error bars. That when we go to the CO bands, the Phoenix model don't fit our observations. It means that the Phoenix model is the atmosphere of this model is too compact to compare it with observations. The Phoenix model have the CO bands, have the CO layers, because in the spectrum we see that in this part of the spectrum it fit very well, but these layers are so close to the photosphere compared with our observations. We observed similar results when we see the uniform diameter versus the wavelength. Here in blue are our observations, the uniform diameter predicted by our observations, and in red is the uniform diameter predicted by the Phoenix model that we use. We see that in the continuum the diameter is constant,
When we arrived to 2.25, that is the beginning of the CO band, we observed a slope, and that the diameter increases a lot of in the CO light.
This one is the similar that we observed in the visibility. It means that in this star, the CO layers are very far to the are very extended. They are very far to the photosphere. But when we see the Phoenix model, that is in red, we see that the they have the diameter increase a little. In the CO lines, but this increase is small that we observed in our observations. It means that it's okay. These models have CO layers, but then are close to the photosphere. In contrast, that we observed in our observations, we also see that the Phoenix model don't have the slope that we observed, and this one is because this model don't have contributions for water. And finally, I saw the cruiser phase versus the wavelength for the same star. We see that the cruiser phase are very near to the zero, so there aren't deviation from the point symmetry. However, our observations are in the first lobe, so we cannot exclude that there are asymmetries in a smaller scale. The rest of the here I saw the results of V7066 Centaurus in the part of the CO layers. We see something similar that we observed with the other star. We see that the Phoenix model don't predict the overextended molecular layers, but in the spectrum the things work better. But in this star we see something different. We see that in the spectrum there are emission light of sodium. And this line in the visibility and in the uniform diameter is extended. So this star also extended layers of sodium. In the closer phase, we see something similar. These stars are a little different for the other red supergiants that we observed, because these stars are more luminosity and more massive, as we see later when we located them in the HR diagram. Also, Chenault et al. Observed this star with interferometry, and they observed that this star are a binary system. We don't, with our data, we cannot say that it's true that this star is, with our data, we cannot have a resolution for see the binary, the companion. But this star is thinking that this star is a binary system. So at the beginning, we don't know if this line is part of the red supergiants or if contributions for the binary, for the companion. So we try to model it with a toy model that we create, that is this one. We create this. It's very simple. It's only for try to understand the origin of this line. We use a uniform disk for modelate the photosphere of the star. Later, we add a rind that is the layer of the sodium, and finally we add a other resolver component that we think that is the dust component that this part. We observe also in the rest of the red supergiants. Only the thing that we do is add this part. When we fit this toy model with with our observation with the sodium light of our observations, we see that the data fit very well. So we think that the sodium line is part of the red giant, and it isn't a contribution for the companion. Finally, I want to show the results of HD183589. This star is also catalogued as red supergiants, but in the spectrum we see similar things, but when we see the visibility and the uniform diameter, we don't observe it future. We don't observe anything of the zeolites. So this star have also zeolites, but in this case the zeolites are near to the photosphere, as predicted the Phoenix model. When we estimated the fundamental parameters of this star and locate them in the HR diagram, we see that this star and three more red supergiants that we observed are located in the red giant region, not in the red supergiant region. So we think that the problem with this star and the other red supergiant that we observed with the same characterization is that are bad catalogued. This star is actually a red giant and not a red supergiant. Also, it is catalogued as red supergiant. Okay, as we see that the Phoenix model don't predict, cannot explain our observations, we try with different theoretical models. First, we try with a convection model with these fundamental parameters. And in this graphic, I saw the intensity versus the radius of the star. In black are the intensity profile for one wavelength for the continuum, and in red is the intensity profile for the first zeolite. We see that the zeolite surface looks more extended than the continuum surface, but when we compare the synthetic visibility for this model with the synthetic visibility of Tinel with the Phoenix model, that is here in green are the visibility of this model, and in red are the visibility from the Phoenix model, we see that the both visibility are similar. So this model don't explain our observations either. So next we do a test with the Codex model. The Codex model, as I said, is a self-pulsation model with fundamental parameters of Mira Star. The fundamental parameters of the Mira Star are lower than the fundamental parameters of our star, but we use only this model as test. In this graphic, I saw the radius of the star versus the time for the model. In red is the for different layers of the star. In red is the photosphere of the star, and this part is the layers of the atmosphere. We see that the internal pulsation produces an irregular movement in the atmospheric layers. We see that in this case, we observe that in this model there are some moments that the atmosphere are very extended. So we decided to use this part of the model where that is now one moment when the atmospheric is very extended, and here I plot the intensity profile for the continuum in blue and for the first CO line. We see that in this case the CO surface is more extended than the photosphere, and this extended is more important that we observe it with the convection model. If we fit this model with all the observations, in this figure, we see that this model fits very well to to our observations, although the fundamental parameters are very different. So the next step is compare our observation with a cell pulsation model, but with the parameters of our stars. And this one is the result. We use a new pulsation model with the parameters of similar that the V600 to Carina. And in this graphic, I show again the radius of the star versus the time for different layers. Again, in red is the photosphere of the star. We see that in this case, the internal pulsation only produces a regular movement in the atmosphere layer. So, the pulsation model with when we use pulsation model with fundamental parameters of red giants, we don't observe extended atmosphere. So, this model cannot explain our observations either. So, the atmosphere, the theoretical model that exists currently cannot explain our observation. So, we think about two possible scenarios where that can explain the atmosphere of this star. The first one is a radiative pressure on molecular lines and dust. In this scenario, we think that the radiative acceleration on molecular lines can levitate the atmosphere until the radii where the dust is formed, and later the radiation on this dust gang can explain the extended atmosphere that we observe. The problem is that there aren't any theoretical model that use this scenario, so we cannot test if this one is possible or not. No, it's possible that if this scenario can explain our observation or not. On the other hand, we think that maybe other scenario can be the magnetic fields. Our collaboration Bernd Freitag produced a radiative aerodynamical simulations with magnetic fields. And in the first test, the stratification of this model didn't be altered when we use magnetic fields. But this one is no conclusions because more calculations are needed. So actually, the mechanisms that explain the atmosphere of the red supergiants are an open debate because there aren't any theoretical model that can explain them. Okay, to finish, I want to show very quickly the result that we obtained for red giants. Sorry, as I said, the first one, we observed this type of stars because we want to compare it with the Phoenix model for test if there are any problem with this model. So we see that in the spectrum we observe a similar thing that the result. We observe a similar thing that the red supergiant. This star also have CO layers, but when we observe the visibility and the uniform diameter, we see that this star don't have extended molecular layer. So, as we see with the red supergiants that we think that are bad catalogued, these stars have CO layers, but then they are near to the photosphere. And the Phoenix model predict well these observations. This one is the result for Epsilon Octave. And in the case of Beta Pegasus, we see similar things. But in this case, we observed a slope in the visibility, but it's not see very well. But in the uniform diameter, see better. This slope, we think that is due to a water band. So in this case, we observed similar thing. This star have CO layers near to the photosphere, but also
a CO water layer that is not predicted by the Phoenix model. Okay, we want to compare all our observations. So in this graphic, I show the our results, our observation of the red supergiants, red giants, and some Mira star that we observed Witkowski et al. In particular, we want to characterize the atmospheric stress, the standard of the atmospheric. So we use a ratio between the visibility in the continuum and the visibility in the first CO lines. And we plot this ratio versus the logarithm of the luminosity and versus the variability of the amplitude. We see that the red supergiants, in blue are the red supergiants, in red are the red giants, and in pink are the Mira stars. And this line is the extension of the atmosphere for the Phoenix model. We see that the red supergiants and the Mira star have similar atmospheric extensions, and the both stars are not consistent with the Phoenix model. However, when we observe the red giants, don't show extended CO layers as we see before, and they are consistent with the Phoenix model. If we see the same ratio versus the luminosity, but in this case we only focus in the red supergiants, we observe a correlation between the atmospheric extensions and the luminosity. We observe that the atmospheric extension increases with increasing luminosity. This one is a preliminary results because this data is observed with medium resolutions, and this ratio is only a preliminary. It's true that this correlation exists, we need a high resolution observation with high resolutions. We hope to this year observe it with AMBER with high resolutions to test if this correlation is true. And for finish, we estimated the fundamental parameters of this star. For that, we fit the Phoenix model in the continuum, that we see that the Phoenix model fit very well to our observations in the continuum, and we estimated the angular diameter. For estimate the fundamental parameters, we take this value and take the distance and the magnitude for the literature and estimate the luminosity and the effective temperature. And we compare the position of the star in the XR diagram with the external evolutionary track. We see that the red supergiant that is plotted here in red are consistent with this evolutionary track. They are positioned in the red limit of this evolutionary track. However, when we see the red giants that are in red here, in orange, this star, this four star, the star that are catalogued as a red supergiant, that is the star that we don't observe extended CO layer, and when we locate them in the X diagram, we see that it's near to the red giant, not to the red supergiant. For this reason, we think that this star are red giants and not red supergiants. Okay, when we observe the red giants, we see that they are located too right to this evolutionary track. So we compare this star with other evolutionary track, in this case with the star called evolutionary model, and we see that in this case the position of the star fit very well with these models. The difference between the both evolutionary models are the missing left. Okay, so for finish, we can conclude that all the stars have CO layers, but only the red supergiant have these layers so extended. We also observed that the red supergiant show correlations between the extended atmosphere and the luminosity, but this correlation is not present in the Mira star.
So we think that there are the mechanisms that explain the atmospheric structure in the Mira star and the red supergiant must be different. And finally, we see that the current theoretical model cannot explain the extended atmosphere that we observe in the red supergiants. So this one is the mechanism that lead to the extended atmosphere in the red supergiant is not known yet. And this one is all.
Okay, we'll have some time for questions. Who wants to start? Very fine.
Hi. I have two questions. So the first one, you define red giants having three to eight solar masses. I guess that's your sample of red giants, right? Because a solar mass star can perfectly be a red giant.
Sorry?
So I'm a bit confused by your definition of red giant in terms of masses.
Yes, okay.
I guess your sample has 3 to 8 solars. You observe intermediate mass red giants, but I mean a solar mass star can be a red giant perfectly. I mean you showed it in the Earth from Russell diagram.
Yeah, it's true. We decided to put the limit in 3 because we see the different literature and we don't. So maybe solar mass. Yeah, the solar is a red. Must be a red giant too. So.
Solar, I mean, horizontal branch stars have 1 to 2 solar masses, so they're not.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, just more a comment / question. I guess probably your sample was limited to intermediate mass stars, I guess, because they're brighter. The other question is, how robust do you think this result of correlation between extended atmosphere and luminosity is? Do you have more data points to come?
This one is
it depends on V76610. If I take this out of the box,
this star is strange compared with the other red supergiants because it's more luminosity. We think that maybe this star is not a red supergiant, maybe it's a yellow hypergiant, and it's a binary system. So maybe these things are that is the reason because they are more lower than the correlation. But as I say, this one is only a preliminary results because the ratio that we estimated is preliminary. We need a data with high resolutions for estimated with better this ratio and observe it if it's true that this correlation exists or not.
We need a much larger sample.
Yeah, we plot only the red supergiant that we observed. We have a time for observation this spring, but we observed the same in high resolution, but we observed the same sample. Also, we have time with Amber in medium resolution to observe more red supergiants for increase this sample and see if it's true that this correlation is true or not. But it's very preliminary results. We cannot say a lot of things about this.
Can you estimate the masses of the CO shells?
Sure.
Can you make some estimates to the masses of the CO shells? Or the total envelope?
No, we don't do any estimations. We cannot also estimate the distance that there are. We only with these observations we only see that they are very extended, but we cannot say exactly the distance for the distance. From the photosphere and the masses, we don't have information.
Can you say something else about this layer, this sodium layer? How did it before? How did it expel from it?
For this one?
Yes.
Okay. This one is some results that we obtained some months ago, and we are working now. We only know that the rest of the red supergiant that we observed don't show this. This CO layer. So Maybe something that happened in this star because it's more luminosity and the internal structure are different than the other red
supernovae. Do you mean contamination from the interstellar medium, for
example? Maybe, but we can when we fit to this toy model that is thinking that the sodium comes to a ring around the star, the data fit very well. So we think that the sodium is something that we observed for the star, not for the environment.
So it was a star.
Yeah, exactly.
Any more questions? I have two curiosities. The first one is when you have plotted all the stars within the HR diagram at the end, which are the this one, yeah. Which are the parameters that you can get from your spectrointerferometric analysis that helps you to locate the stars within this diagram?
Mm-hmm.
Which are those parameters that you can estimate from,
yeah,
from the visibilities?
Okay, we estimated the angular diameter with our observations and the rest of the magnitude that we the rest of the magnitude that we needed, the volumetric flux and the distance we take for the literature. So for this reason the error bar is very big because these stars have a variability. So we take the magnitude for estimated fundamental parameters, we take the magnitude for different catalogues.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't know if this we don't know. We know that the magnitude for the different catalogues is taken in different times. So maybe it's taken in different moment of the phase.
Mm-hmm.
So, but we don't have information to estimate the, with the photometry information that we have, we cannot estimate the magnitude for this star. So it's an approximation to estimate the volumetric flux.
Mm-hmm.
The distance normally is better obtained because these stars are normally in cluster, so the distance is very narrow, but the volumetric flux is something similar. There are some studies before to estimate the fundamental parameters of this star, and our estimations are is similar to the other people at the time.
Mm-hmm. Second question is, there was a press release from ESO some months ago, I don't remember when, 2 or 3 months ago, in which they claim that the size of these envelopes could be related with the size of the dust grains.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, in these envelopes. Do you have any comment on that?
About the dust?
I assume you have still the problem of how to levitate these atmospheres,
yeah,
until the place where these dust grains have fallen.
But
it looks like, according to this press release, I haven't read the paper, it was just reading the press release, they mentioned that those more extended envelopes correspond to these cases in which the dust grains are larger.
Yeah, I forget to say, but we tried to observe it, the dust component of this star with BC to try to, because we know that this star have a over-resolved common component that we think that is from dust, but we don't know exactly where is this dust. And maybe if this dust is near to the photosphere, maybe around 2 stellar radius, it can be part of the mechanics that explain the stellar. So we try to observe it with BC to observe it, the dust component, to because we don't have imaging for the dust component. With BC, we try to observe it for first time, the dust component, and to see where is the exactly the position of this star, and if possible, of the mechanism.
I always thought that it was accepted that dust is in the wings of these stars. That's why they're called dust-driven.
Yes, this star have dust, but we don't know exactly where is this dust. If the dust is near to the photosphere, it can be part of the mechanism. But if this dust is very far, is necessary other mechanisms that levitate the atmosphere very very far, and the atmosphere, the acceleration on the molecular lines Can levitate the atmosphere, but only near to the photosphere, not very far. Maybe around two stellar radius, but not very more. So it's important to know exactly where is this dot. If it's near to the photosphere or if it's so far.
How many stellar radii are typically for the position of these layers? Is 8, 10, something like that?
Yes, something similar, but it's not exactly the position of this star. We also try to observe it with Pioneer, to observe an imaging, and to estimate better the position, the radius of this molecular layer.
Any other questions? Okay, then let's send the line again for the talk. It has been the first talk that has been recorded. Okay, then it will be on the webpage. Okay, see you next time.
Yeah.